Erica Noyes, the Senior Development and Communication Associate, joined Helping Hands in 2011. She provides fundraising, communication, event planning, graphic design experience, and sometimes even photographs the monkeys who are training. Erica graduated from Bennington College with a degree in photography and music. After graduation, she moved to Boston and began her career working for multiple nonprofit organizations, which led her to stumble upon Helping Hands, and she was thrilled to combine her love of animals and her passion for helping people. So, let's get started.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me okay? I apologize, I'm getting over a cold, so if I go into a massive coughing fit, just ignore me. So thank you for the introduction. I'm excited to be here to talk about our program. I'll address the first question is, why didn't you bring a monkey? So our monkeys are, our program is all about restoring independence within your own home. So to bring a monkey out in public would be off mission for us. Also, capuchin monkeys, they don't think they're anything special. So they don't like to be the center of attention normally. So, because you guys could imagine, if you saw a monkey like in the grocery store or at the movie theater, what would be your first reaction?
There's a monkey.
There's a monkey, right. You'd probably want to run up and go see it and figure out what was going on. It would be very scary and overwhelming for them. And to be in front of a big group of people is scary. So we don't bring them out in public. But I do have a bunch of videos and pictures about our program. So we were founded in 1979, sort of as an experiment. An occupational therapist was listening to her clients talk about the frustrations that they had. And they were all, you know, just with fine motor skills. And so she thought, well, capuchin monkeys have thumbs, opposable thumbs like we do. Perhaps that would be a way to help people living with paralysis, and that's how Helping Hands is born. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you a video that's gonna bring in to the room the voice that you don't often hear in our presentations, which is the voice of our recipients. Our recipients are mostly homebound. They spend most of their time at home. So you'll really get to know a little bit about why our recipients apply for our program.
I think the first time we heard about the monkey was in a magazine article. So in an idle moment, she went on the internet and looked up monkeys, helpers, and came up with these people in Boston. And the website said something about, if you'd like a monkey, send us an email. And I think in our minds, and we thought nothing would ever come of it. And about 3 days later, we got an email back.
Judy sent a letter initially that really did strike us as being really unique, really from the heart. It made us laugh, it made us want to know more about her. This Helping Hands has learned over the last 32 years what works and how we can build a relationship between a service animal and a recipient.
Son, good boy.
We've taken the time and the energy to build this process because we know how important it is.
You go fetch? Atta girl Daisy, atta girl.
We all run around this world going 100 miles an hour. But the people that we help are adults who have had that ability taken from them. And to be able to give that gift back, even if it's in the form of a 6-pound monkey helping, that partnership that we have seen again and again, that is what makes Helping Hands work.
Jude is immobile in her chair, and if she goes for the phone and it slips out of her hands and hits the floor, it's 18 inches away, and it might as well be 18 miles away. So we went, wow, if this monkey could pick up a phone, that would be terrific.
One of the things that Judy was looking for was a monkey that would be able to fetch objects off of the floor, off of a shelf. Really, what the monkeys learn over time is to anticipate their recipient's needs. For example, something as simple as walking into a dark room and flipping on a light switch is impossible for Judy. Sophie's able to fill that void.
I had kind of a not much life. And then Sophie came and became, that's what I wanted to do, was hang out with that monkey. I think I'm her prized person. When I go in the room, she makes more fuss over me, and I love that.
She was sitting in Jude's lap the other day, and Jude was sort of mindlessly stroking her and stopped and Sophie reached out her small black hand and grabbed Judith's hand and dragged it back because it was clear that she wasn't done being stroked. Everybody lit up. It was a great moment. As it happened, she's been with us for a year today. It's her anniversary. And I don't know how I could have gotten through this year without her.
One of the things that's very important to a lot of our recipients is that their monkey doesn't see them as disabled. They don't recognize the things that they're unable to do. Their monkey sees the recipient as protector, as alpha. And that's really important. It's a really important gift that monkeys give to somebody who's had so much taken away from them.
So my friend said, a monkey? What are you a monkey? What are you gonna do with a monkey? What? How have I lived so long without a monkey? Is really the question. Come to find out I was right. She's really cool.
That video was made in 2011. And it was an interesting situation. Judy and George actually live in Vermont. And we, Helping Hands, worked with the Vermont legislature in order to change the laws so that Judy could have a helper monkey in her home in the state of Vermont. So, about Helping Hands. I'm gonna go back here so I'm not blocking anything. We aim to make 6 to 8 placements across the U.S. every year. That is while supporting all of our other active placements across the country. We've found that that's about what we can handle as an organization. We're very small. We have about 11 and a half people on staff, which includes 2 veterinary technicians. We provide 24-hour support for all of our recipients and all of our monkeys. We've definitely gotten those phone calls in the middle of the night saying, my monkey got into the tortillas and is on top of a shelf and eating them, and what do I do? There's always somebody available for emergency and non-emergency questions or concerns or anything. We care for our monkeys for their entire lives. If for some reason a recipient is going away, like if they're going on a vacation or they are going to into the hospital for an amount of time, we will bring the monkey back to Helping Hands for babysitting, no matter where they are in the country, if they're in California or if they're in Concord. We'll bring the monkey back for babysitting, take care of that monkey until the recipient is well enough or back in order to have the monkey back, and then we'll bring the monkey back to them. And all of our training, placement, and support is provided free of charge to our recipients. It costs us about $40,000 per monkey to train, place, and support. But it's really important to us that our services are free of charge to our recipients. The history, I went over this a little bit. It was founded by an OT. The original monkeys for our program were actually donated, and I just found this out after working at Helping Hands for 7 years. I just found out that the original monkeys were donated to our program from Disneyland. And the subsequent monkeys were all bred for our program at the Southwick Zoo in Mendon, Massachusetts. So if you ever go there and go to the Capuchins, some of those monkeys are actually cousins to the monkeys in our program. We do have a closed colony, which means we don't accept monkeys from outside of our breeding program, because then we know everything that the monkeys have ever been exposed to in terms of diseases, that type of thing, and it keeps our population very healthy. Our first placement was Robert Foster and Hellion. They were together for 27 years before Robert passed away in 2007. Hellion passed away about 5 years later. But they were our first and our longest placement. Monkeys live between 20 and 25 years in the wild, and live between 30 and 40 years in captivity. Our oldest monkey, she was 44 when she passed away. So why did we choose Capuchin monkeys? Capuchin monkeys are typically a great size. They're about 6 to 8 pounds, although we do have our 4-pound peanuts and we have our big 12-pound boys. Just like people, they all come in all shapes and sizes. They are extremely smart and curious, and they love to manipulate objects. You never want to leave your coffee unattended with a monkey nearby, because that monkey will get into your coffee immediately. They can do all sorts of things. They have opposable thumbs, so they do many, many tasks that our recipients have trouble with. Their size to strength ratio is very high. So even though they are only about 6 to 8 pounds, they are strong enough to reposition an arm or a leg on a wheelchair after a muscle spasm. And like I said, their lifespan is between 30 and 40 years.
Helping Hands began in 1979 as an experiment to see if we could train a capuchin monkey to help somebody living with a spinal cord injury. Capuchin monkeys are known as the most intelligent New World monkeys. They're also a great size, typically about 6 to 8 pounds as adults, although Dylan's a little bit smaller than that. We take advantage of the monkey's natural hierarchy when we are forming the bond between a monkey and his or her recipient. A monkey wants to put a recipient at the top of their hierarchy, so that's what makes them want to do tasks and to work together as a team. Our recipients have been robbed of their independence through injury and illness. And what a monkey is able to do is bring them something positive, let them set new goals, provide them that independence, even in small ways.
Good girl!
We affectionately call our building the Monkey College. We typically have about 50 monkeys in our building at any given time. The number fluctuates due to babysitting and who's coming in and who's going out. And we call it the Monkey College because they typically spend between 3 to 5 years in training. So, like people, though, monkeys are each individuals. So, you know, some of our valedictorians can go through it in 2. They just learn their tasks really quickly. Some of our other maybe not so smart or not so motivated monkeys, you know, will take a little longer. All of our training is literally based on monkey see, monkey do. It's all imitation-based positive reinforcement. And we use verbal praise and small food rewards to reinforce the task training that we do with our monkeys. The strongest you will ever hear a trainer in our building correct a monkey is uh-uh. We save the word no for very serious situations, like if a monkey is about to put, for example, a pill or something that in their mouth, or they're about to like eat an ant trap that's poisonous. You know, we reserve the word no for very serious situations so that they know that that is something that they have to follow. Each of our monkeys has an individual relationship with one trainer. Monkeys are hierarchical, so they rank everyone on their hierarchy. So their trainer is their alpha, their top person. And then everyone else is ranked below their trainer or in a home, their recipient. So a good analogy for that is their trainer is the top person, and then all of the other trainers are sort of aunts. I say aunts because we happen to be all female. So a monkey will still respect other trainers, but only wants to really listen and do tasks and do things for their alpha, for their main trainer.
Basic level cubicle training really starts with using toys and objects the monkeys have seen before in their homes. So if I can teach a monkey how to put a ball in a cup or stack rings, I can teach them a more complicated task.
When we stack rings, I have all the rings spread out and I shine the laser on what ring I want her to put onto the tube. And I say,
do this.
And she knows to pick that ring to stack.
Nice work, Dylan.
The most important thing in cubicle is that a monkey learns to follow their trainer's actions and really focus in on exactly what the trainer is asking them to do.
Dylan, can you do this?
We want to make sure that we're teaching tasks and behaviors and not just tricks.
Dylan, can you do this?
So that later in the process, if we're teaching something more advanced, the monkeys are understanding the individual sections that it takes to put that task together.
So all of our training is based on doing tasks for a recipient. We have, the monkeys can do very many, many, many things. The most requested task is fetch, for fetching dropped objects off the floor or fetching things from a countertop. They can also, I know I mentioned repositioning an arm or leg in a wheelchair after a muscle spasm. They can turn pages in a book or magazine, push glasses up on somebody's nose, scratch itches on somebody's face. When I first got to Helping Hands, I got to see a training demo where Mango went to a mini fridge, got a bottle of water, took it to a bottle tray, put it in, took the top off, put a straw in it to prepare it for his trainer to drink. And I thought that was amazing. I was like, this is so cool. This has got to be so hard to teach them. And his trainer said, well, no, actually, they love to manipulate objects. This is really fun for them. She said, the hardest thing to teach a monkey is to only flip the light switch once, because it's so much fun to flip it on and off and on and off as many times as you can. There are three stages of training in our building. And one of the things that we do is all of our monkeys, by the time they leave the building, they are potty trained. They're potty trained to return to their cage for potty activities. Their cage is like their bedroom. It's their safe zone. It's where all their favorite toys are. It's where all their favorite blankets are. It's where they get all of their meals. It's where if they're not feeling like they want to hang out with their recipient or not, you know, just not having an off day, they'll go to their cage and shut the door and usually cover up in their fleece blankets. You'll see in a lot of our videos that our monkeys are diapered, and that is because monkeys really thrive on routine. And when we do filming and photography, it's outside of their normal routine. And so they, you know, could get nervous and they could have an accident, and they know they're not supposed to have an accident, and that can make them feel bad. So we always want to make our monkeys as comfortable as possible. So you will see them diapered in a lot of our films and videos, but they are all potty trained. And typically, our training takes between 3 to 5 years, but just depends on the monkey. A lot of things depend on the monkey. So here's a little bit about more advanced training of our monkeys.
As training progresses, we are spending a lot more time in between tasks so that we're not just drilling task after task, but we're trying to make it more like it would be in a real home. Little everyday tasks like teaching a monkey how to turn the lights on and off is important to a recipient. It's a fun task to teach for a monkey at first, but then we have to teach them only to flip it once. When you first introduce a monkey to a light switch, they want to flip it on and off as many times as they can. So getting them to back off from that behavior and learn either once up or once down is important.
So with flipping a page in a magazine, I would first start by isolating a single page with a fold and telling the monkey, Mango, do this. And then flipping the page very deliberately and elaborately so that they can see exactly what I'm doing. And at first, we only reward them for baby steps. So for example, turning the page of a magazine, even if he just grabbed a bunch of pages, eventually I would get a little more picky and I would ask him to only flip one page. But what's important to teach them is inhibiting the behavior to keep flipping pages and to just do one at a time and to just do it only when I ask.
Drink is one of the first chain commands that we teach the monkeys, which is when we take several different task behaviors and link them together. We are asking them to change the bottle, flip it right side up if necessary, open the top, and put a straw in the bottle.
We're gonna flip. Atta girl, open. Straw. Good job, Daisy.
Over the years of training the monkeys, we have learned to understand what's important to recipients, what those little everyday tasks are that they're hoping to have help with.
So, like I said before, we teach a lot of different tasks at the Monkey College. Fetch dropped objects, phones, remotes, mouse sticks. One of our applicants in his application, you know, he wrote that, you know, he had a mouse stick and then he would drop that mouse stick, and so he would get another mouse stick so that he could pick up the mouse stick, and soon he had a pile of mouse sticks on the floor. He's like, a monkey could really help me deal with that situation. Our monkeys can turn pages in books or magazines. One of our monkeys actually helped a young woman in Louisiana graduate from college because her monkey turned the pages in her textbooks for her while she studied. Excuse me. They can scratch itches on your face using a soft cloth, open water bottles, flip light switches, push buttons. load CDs or DVDs into players, and all of our tasks are done within the home environment only. As I said before, it would be too overwhelming and scary for them to be out in public. Not to mention, if you took a monkey to a grocery store where there's all sorts of candy and fruit and all sorts of temptations all around, it would be very hard for them to focus on the jobs that they would be supposed to be doing, and they would just want to basically stuff everything into their face. Capuchins really like sugar. If they could, they would eat bananas and fruit all day long. Primates are very prone to becoming diabetic, though, so we have to be very careful with their diet and with what they eat. They eat a lot healthier than we do. So when we're working with a recipient or with an applicant, we want to make sure that they're applying for a monkey helper with reasonable expectations. So monkeys aren't taught any task requiring medications or other medical care. It always blows my mind when somebody is like, well, can my monkey help with my catheter? Like, nah, it's probably, no, definitely not. Realistic expectations regarding food tasks. It wouldn't be fair to like ask your monkey to feed you M&Ms without them eating any themselves, so we don't actually ask our monkeys to do anything with food. And it's the same thing with personal care tasks, such as brushing your teeth or brushing your hair. You know, a monkey wouldn't know really what to do in terms of brushing your hair, and you know, toothpaste smells really good, and so a monkey would potentially eat that toothpaste, which could be very harmful for them. So we avoid having them do any sort of personal care tasks. Anything that you would trust a toddler to do for you is sort of how we look at what we teach our monkeys to do for our recipients. And in a home, you know, it's always really important that the monkey's safety comes first. So who has a monkey helper? When the program started back in 1979, it was started with funding from the government. They were actually looking at people coming back from serving in the military who maybe had, you know, amputations or spinal cord injuries. They were really interested in seeing how they could cut costs and maybe replace human caretakers with monkey helpers. So we only focused on spinal cord injury at the beginning of our program. After a while, we branched out into all sorts of different mobility impairments. Spinal cord injury, we talked about that. Multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy, AMA, ALS, we have had some success placing with, but because it's such a degenerative disease and they can, it's can be hard for the monkey, we can't place with conditions like Parkinson's. Because the irregularity of the recipient's movements would be very overwhelming and a little scary for the monkeys. So there are some challenges with the degenerative diseases, but these are basically our who we serve. So what makes a good applicant? One of the most important things is to be at least 1 year post-injury or diagnosis. This gives the applicant a chance to really get into their routine and to sort of figure out their new life. We've, you know, a lot of things change suddenly in that first year, and so we want to make sure that they're set and stable in their condition. There can be no small children in the home. It can be really confusing for a kid to have a monkey in the home and be like, why can't the monkey play with me? It's also there's a reason we can't place with children, which is the monkeys don't see children as someone who's worthy of their respect. A monkey will never choose a child as their alpha. They will see them as a playmate, but not as someone that they want to do tasks for. So all of our recipients need to be adults themselves, and there can be no children under the age of 12 in the home. The majority of the recipient's time needs to be spent at home. Monkeys are very social creatures, so the recipient can't be at a full-time job outside the home. It's not fair to the monkey. Strong support system. So there has to be a stable care attendant system in the home environment. We encourage our recipients to do as much care for their monkey as possible, but we know that some of our quadriplegics cannot do all the care for their monkeys. So there needs to be a stable care attendant system, whether it's a paid attendant or a family member in that home. A desire for companionship. A lot of our recipients come into our program thinking about all the tasks and the independence that their monkey can provide. And then later on, they're like, I had no idea that the companionship was going to be the most valuable part. You know, my monkey doesn't get my laundry out of the washing machine, but I couldn't imagine my life without her. And I think the most important piece of our program is to have patience and a sense of humor, because monkeys are not robots, and lots of unexpected things will happen, and you just have to sort of go with the flow and have a sense of humor about living with a monkey. And honestly, if you're going to think about bringing a monkey into your home, you probably have a good sense of humor. Our application requirements are pretty hefty, and we do that on purpose. So we ask the recipients or the applicants to do a written application. We have them do references, both personal and medical. We do phone interviews, we do Skype interviews. They have to make a video of their home environment and introduce us to the people who are often in the home. And then we also then go visit the home. So this is twofold. Bringing a monkey into your house is not like bringing in a cat or a dog. Monkeys are very complex animals, and they need that routine, and we need to make sure that we pick the right monkey for that environment. Monkeys are sexist. Some prefer men, others prefer women. Some monkeys are really, really terrified of dogs and could never be in a home with a dog. Other monkeys are okay with dogs. I don't say they love dogs, but some of them are okay. Cats, they consider cats to be so far beneath them, they pretty much ignore cats in the home. But the biggest piece of our program, I hope this is the next slide, is the monkey matching. The most important thing is that we get the personality match right. Some monkeys prefer a big, active household with lots of things going on. Other monkeys really need a quiet environment with when it's just them and their recipient. It really just depends on the monkey. They all have their really distinct individual personalities. One of our monkeys, just to demonstrate their individual personalities, one of our monkeys is head over heels, absolutely loves Barack Obama. Anytime that man comes on the TV, this monkey makes happy noises, this monkey flirts with the TV, like it's hilarious. On the flip side, we have another monkey who for some reason really, really, really dislikes Regis Philbin. And we literally have to change the channel anytime Regis Philbin comes on because this monkey gets really, really upset. And then we have another monkey who is totally in love with Vanna White. Just again, happy noises, flirting with the TV. It's unbelievable. So they all have their very distinct personalities. So we joke that we are a dating service, because we have to get that personality match right. And you know, we have almost 40 years of experience in monkey matching, but we will, you know, occasionally we will get the personality match wrong. And we will correct it and make sure that personality, we can train the monkey to do the tasks that the person needs, but if that personality match isn't there, that monkey is never going to do tasks as well as they could. So what happens when we find the perfect personality match is we send a placement team to the home. It's typically about 5 to 7 days that they spend there. The first day they arrive, they typically set up the monkey's enclosure. They monkey-proof the home. Sometimes they build adaptive equipment for the recipient to help with different things that the monkey will be doing. And they start teaching the recipient and their family about life with the monkey. It's typically 5 to 7 days. And in these 5 to 7 days is when we would discover that, you know, we may have not gotten the personality match right. There was a woman in Georgia who we brought the monkey down. We're like, this is not gonna work. So we brought the monkey back, but now we had a really good sense of her and her personality. Brought a different monkey, and they have been together for 7 years now. doing great. So like I said, it's all about the personality match. After we have left the monkey at the home, we come back to Boston. And it's not like we've dropped off a monkey and said, here is your monkey, good luck. We start right when we come back to Boston. Basically every day we are on Skype with our recipients, continuing to teach them about life with a monkey and continuing to teach them about how to interpret what their monkey's telling them, you know, behaviors with their monkey. So it starts off, it's a conversation every day. Skype has been just a lifesaver for us because we can actually see the recipient and the monkey interact. Over time, it finally, you know, the recipient will talk to us once a week, then maybe every other week, and then maybe once a month. But we are always in touch with our recipients throughout the entire lifetime of their placement. And we are always available for anything that they need. For example, one of our monkeys unfortunately developed cancer. And so we went and picked up the monkey and brought her back to Boston. We have a veterinary advisory committee that treats all of our serious cases. And you know, they did treat her. And she was responding well to treatment. And then unfortunately, she passed away of an unrelated issue. But we are, you know, we cover all of their veterinary care for their entire lives. So some of the psychological benefits that we hear from our recipients, you know, my monkey needs me as much as I need him. The monkeys don't see the recipients as being broken. You know, they'll look at a recipient and say, well, that's different, but I really like them, so I'm gonna find a way to make their life easier. Our monkeys give people a reason to wake up in the morning. A lot of our recipients say, you know what, I could just stay in bed, it's not a big deal, but I know that I've got to get up because my monkey needs to get out and get fed, and you know, she's really the reason I'm getting out of bed in the morning. Something to focus on other than their loss, injury, or illness, and my monkey doesn't look at me like I'm different or broken. One of the best parts of my job is I get to interview our recipients on big anniversaries. So when they've been together with their monkey helper for 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. And I am the office softie, I will tell you that. Every time I have a conversation, I end up in tears because the recipients are just amazing people. And to hear like the different ways that their monkey has given them some independence back is just really incredible. So I know I've told you that all of our services are provided free of charge. I just figure I'd break it out a little bit and let you know how we can make that happen. The majority of our funding comes from foundation support. We have a very good base of foundations that really believe in the power that the human-animal bond has to change lives. So that's where the majority of our funding comes from. And then the rest of it is really individual giving and special events. We do one event a year in Boston to support our program, but most of our funding is individual donations. And I talked about the veterinary care. One of the other pieces of our program is that we need to contract with a local vet in the area of our placement who is willing to see a monkey. They don't have to have any primate experience. They just need to be willing to see a monkey. Our two vet techs on staff will walk them through the process of doing a blood test on a monkey and all that stuff. So they just need to be willing. We have a very strict diet for our monkeys. Like I said, primates can be very prone to becoming diabetic. So the staple of their diet is monkey chow. It's kind of a large soft biscuit. Looks like dog chow a little bit. Tastes like cardboard. The monkeys love it. So they get that. They get one small piece of fruit a day, and then healthy snacks throughout the day, such as cucumbers, unsweetened, unsalted peanut butter, unsweetened oatmeal, chicken. They love Brussels sprouts. Monkeys are crazy for Brussels sprouts. We try to avoid sweet vegetables, such as like carrots. But yeah, they eat healthier than any of us do, which is part of the reason that they live between 30 and 40 years in captivity. We do have a veterinary advisory board in Boston that deals with all of our veterinary needs and any major issues that might come up. And we do have two vet techs on staff for immediate emergency help. And it gives our veterinary advisory committee the opportunity to make contributions to veterinary science in regards to primates. And there have been several papers written by members of our veterinary advisory committee on the care of capuchins. For more information, we have a website. It's a great website. There's tons of videos, there's tons of interviews, lots more information. Monkeyhelpers.org. If you Google Monkey Helpers, you get us. We're the only ones in the world who do this kind of work. We're also on, I have to update my slide, we're on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube, and Instagram. We have a monthly e-newsletter as well, where you get information about our program, about our recipients, and about our monkeys. So I'm going to open it up to questions because I know people always have questions about monkeys. Yes?
How many recipients or like applications do you guys get over the year?
So it's an interesting question because we get thousands of inquiries. We send out probably a couple of hundred applications. Typically, we only get back maybe 20 a year because it is really intense. And some people take, we actually just got an application back that we sent out 4 years ago. People take a long time to fill out their applications. And then typically, you know, typically we pace between 6 and 8 monkeys per year.
So when someone does an application, mm-hmm. how long does it take before, like say, like the process, how long does that
take? It's a good question. Again, it really depends on the person and the personality, because sometimes we will have the right monkey, like immediately we'll know, we'll be like Dippy, that would be the perfect monkey for this person. Mm-hmm. And Dippy is ready right now, so we can have a monkey in your home in 3 months. Sometimes we are like, well, Shelly would be the perfect personality match, but Shelly just needs a few more months of training before she's appropriate. So it's, there isn't really a waiting list or a set time as to how long after you would get the monkey after completing the application process. Recently we had an applicant who was accepted, we picked a monkey, and then the applicant was like, oh, I'm having hand surgery. Maybe we should wait like 6 more months until that's finished. And so we ended up delaying the placement for another 6 months until the recipient was ready to have the monkey. So I apologize, a lot of my answers are gonna be like, well, it depends. Yes?
Are there people who received monkeys and live at home with family, but then later go on to say nursing home or group home?
There are, and unfortunately, once they move to a group home is not an appropriate place for a monkey. So if you do have to live within your own home, whether it's a house, apartment, condo, they can't be placed in a group home situation. Yeah.
If you had a recipient, like say in California, would you drive all the way to California with the monkey?
We actually fly.
Really?
Yep. Okay. You may have been on a plane with a monkey and not known it. They fly in little carriers that go under the seat in front of the trainers. Like I said, monkeys don't like to be the center of attention and, you know, like they just would rather stay in their little carrier. So usually they are super quiet. You would see a monkey at an airport because we have to walk them through the metal detector. So occasionally we will, you know, get tagged on Facebook and be like, I saw a monkey in the airport. And that's usually one of our monkeys being walked through security by a trainer. But yes, we do fly with the monkeys. We fly all over the country.
So like when you were talking about when one of the monkeys had cancer and then ended up passing away, mm-hmm. did that, so like when that happens, is the recipient, like if they were still like thriving and would still love a monkey, do mm-hmm. they receive a new monkey or mm-hmm. do they go through the process all over?
They don't have to go through the process all over. So I'll talk about that situation in general. When Tracy died, Stephanie was devastated. Like she and Tracy, you know, Tracy would paint with Stephanie. Stephanie was an artist and they would make paintings together. And she was totally devastated. And so she took a few months and she wasn't really sure if her heart could take another monkey. And she finally decided that, you know, I think I'm ready. She's like, I miss the monkey sounds in my home. I could really use the help. Like, yes, I'm ready for another monkey. So we looked at our monkey population and found another monkey and brought Mikey to Stephanie, and they are doing great. Stephanie's had to adjust a little bit, you know, whereas Tracy was really interested in painting and being artistic with her, Mikey has absolutely no interest in that whatsoever. Mikey is more interested in caring for Stephanie. They're still trying to find like the passion that they can have together. But in terms of personality wise, it's really interesting. Mikey is actually a better fit for Stephanie. And I think Stephanie refers to Mikey as her little athlete because Mikey is very active and loves to fetch things and loves to protect her and loves to like threaten the birds outside the window and that type of thing. Yes?
Who names the monkeys?
They were all named by different people. Our monkeys, I realized somebody took a slide out of my presentation. The monkeys grew up in foster homes, which was basically a home that volunteered to raise a monkey until they were mature enough to come to monkey college, which is, they are usually between 10 and 15 when they come into the monkey college. So sometimes it was their foster parents, sometimes it was the board members of Helping Hands, and sometimes it was the trainers. We haven't bred monkeys for our program in about 15 years. We have a very healthy population of monkeys at the moment. So I don't actually know anyone who has named a monkey, if that makes sense. Yes?
How many monkeys do you have ready to go at any given time?
I would say we have about 20 monkeys ready to go at any time, but it also depends on the needs of the recipient. So for example, one of our valedictorians, we would want to place with a, you know, with a high-level quadriplegic because they can do all of the tasks, whereas a paraplegic maybe doesn't need, you know, an itch scratched on their face, but, you know, fetching a dropped object off the floor would be life-changing for them. So maybe one of our not so smart or not so motivated, hasn't done, gone through all of the stages of training would be good for that person. So it just sort of depends on the situation at the time, if that makes sense. Yeah. Okay. Yes?
Does a recipient have to be 100%
bushy? It's a good question. I know we have placed with people who are wheelchair bound most of the time, but have used a walker to get around. Our monkeys are most used to wheelchairs, and so that's where they're going to be most comfortable. And so we do try to place with people who are mostly dependent on wheelchairs. Yes?
I just wondering, how old are the adults that
Well, the people who are applying have to be over 18. I think our youngest recipient was 19. Like, he was injured in a diving accident. Actually, yeah, this is Bradley. Bradley was injured when he was 19, dove into a quarry without checking the level of the water and broke his neck. And I believe he was 18, and I believe he got Jerry when he was 19, so that's pretty much as young as we want. The monkeys tend to see anybody younger than that as playmates instead of someone who could be their alpha.
So you mentioned they're on like a strict diet for food.
Yep.
What do trainers feed them as like a positive?
Peanut butter. Monkeys go mad for peanut butter. They love peanut butter. Small licks of peanut butter is exactly what they use in training. Although, again, it depends on the monkey. We have one monkey who prefers hummus to peanut butter. I don't know why. So it just really depends on the monkey. So if you were working with Winston, you would use hummus. But if you were working with any of our other monkeys, you would use peanut butter.
Are they trained to react to emergency situations?
They are not. So they can... It can be a little tricky because some of the monkeys who like an active household, if they realize that if you push that life alert, suddenly there's tons of people in the house, the monkey may just do that. We had one monkey, so our recipient was on a ventilator at night, and the monkey realized that when the monkey wanted attention, they would just rattle the ventilator, not disconnect it, but rattle it enough so that the alarms would go off and people would come into the room. So they're very smart. You would never trust a monkey to call 911 at an appropriate time. So they're not really trained for that. We have had recipients tell us, though, that their monkey has alerted family members to when they were in medical distress. So it's not a quantifiable, like, we don't train them to do that, and we wouldn't recommend people try to use them in that situation, but. Do you guys have any other questions? Cool. All right. Well, I brought a bunch of materials if you guys are interested. It all has our website on it. I would totally encourage you to visit our website. It's very thorough. My favorite monkey, there's a film about my favorite monkey. I'm not supposed to have favorites. But it's called Great Beginnings. Siggy was placed in 2015 with a Navy veteran out in California. And she's unique in our program. She's a black and white capuchin. The majority of our monkeys are brown tufteds, and she is a black and white. So she's an extremely confident monkey because the other monkeys would pick on her at the monkey college because she was different. So she's super confident. But the movie is called Great Beginnings. It's a great film about the two of them. There's also a smaller piece about Ned and Casey, who just celebrated their 10-year anniversary together. And they live right here in Massachusetts, and they're a wonderful pair. So feel free to come up and take information, or if you have any questions, you're more than welcome to ask me.